Okay. So, believe it or not, we've already talked about changing variables. Today we're going to talk about a general change and what that means. So, let's say this represents the xy plane. And let's say here we have some region R. And in particular, any point can be labeled as x, y. Perhaps over here, we have a region S that corresponds to this region R, just with a different set of variables. So let's call them u and v. Now, the ones that we've talked about are r and theta. Okay, not necessarily. And, of course, these correspond to coordinates. Any point will be u, v. Now, the notation is that there's a rule that we call t that takes all the ordered pairs u and v and turns them into ordered pairs x and y. And if we wanted to, we can go back the other way. We just call that the inverse of t. So before we get started with how this plays a role in what we're doing currently, let's just look at a general transformation example. So let's say that let's let t be the transformation from the UV plane to the XY plane, defined by x equals 1/4 u plus v and y equals 1/2 u minus v. So just to kind of get the feel for what all this is, let's do a few things. One, let's find the corresponding coordinates when u is 1 and v is 3. So that translates to what x and what y?
1 and 0.
Good. So, I mean, this is u, this is v, plug them in, those are the ordered pairs. Okay? Now, let's go ahead and sketch the image under t bounded by negative 2 is between u, or u is between negative 2 and 2, and so is v. So, I mean, this will kind of illustrate why it's sometimes nice to think about a function or an integral in terms of different variables. So, for instance, currently, if this is our u and this is our v-axis, what kind of region do we have?
Square.
So from negative 2 to 2, right? Okay, so this is what we say is S. Pretty nice region to work with, right? Now, just to take a look at what T does, you know, if we're looking at the XY plane, what we can do is sketch several U and V curves. And you could just plug in some constants, like let's say u equals negative 2, so if we're between negative 2 to 2, we can plug in negative 2 to 2. And we can do the same for v. Now, to kind of see what's going on, so currently we have, back up here, where are they? That x is 1/4 u plus v, y is 1/2 u minus v. Okay, our goal is going to be to try to express these transformation equations the other way around, so get u and v in terms of x and y. So what are u and v in terms of x and y? Okay, and if we can do that, then we'll get a better idea of what the image is going to look like in the xy plane. All right, so let's look at u. Well, let's look at both of them. If I take the first equation, which is x equals 1/4 u plus v.
All freshmen going to the Latino Summit at Harper College, please meet in the back foyer. Any freshmen going to the Latino Summit at Harper, meet in the back foyer.
So if I look at the first one that we have, if I multiply by 4, we get 4x equals u plus v. And let's clean up the second one. The second one we have y equals 1/2 u minus v. So let me double that. So we get 2y equals u minus v. And now if I add the equations together, we get what? 4x plus 2y, right? I thought you said y, but I could have been wrong. Okay. So 4x plus 2y equals 2u. And now if we subtract, now we get 4x minus 2y equals what? 2v. So now we're almost there. Here we see that u is going to be 2x plus y. And now here we see that v, we see that v is going to be 2x minus y. Okay, so now if we want to figure out what the region is going to look like, plugging in those constants that we talked about, so if we're looking at u, let's say u is negative 2 to start. That corresponds to the equation 2x plus y equals negative 2. In other words, y equals negative 2x minus 2. If I plug in u equals negative 1, you're going to get y equals negative 2x minus 1, and so on and so forth. If we do that for v, we have 2x minus y equals, let's start with negative 2. So this will be for v equals negative 2, v equals negative 1. So here we'll have 2x plus 2 equal to y. When v is negative 1, let's see, that's just going to change the y-intercept to plus 1. And so on. Okay, so we basically just get that the, where is my picture here? That these horizontal and vertical lines that we have here, so this, let's see, first we did u equals negative 2. So this line right here, u equals negative 2, also corresponds to another line. And what's that? If this is the u-axis, if this is the u-axis, then this would be u, you're right, it'd be v equals negative 2, thanks. So for v equals negative 2, we also have a line in the xy plane. It's just not horizontal anymore. Now it's the equation 2x plus 2 equals y. Okay, so if we put these together, Let's see. If I did the U curves first, what was the pattern for our equation? The slope was always negative 2. The y-intercept was just going down, right, or whatever the U value is. So we have, wrong way. So this corresponds to U equals negative 2. We have a slope of negative 2, y-intercept of negative 2, and I just did positive. So let me just, you didn't see that. U equals 2. That's what that'll be. We need that line anyway. This will be U equals negative 2. If I did the other ones, the V curves, this corresponds to, let's see, that was V equals negative 2. It's just the opposite y-intercept with a positive 2 slope. And if I went all the way down to V equals 2, that would correspond to this one. And do you guys kind of understand that all the other values would just be lines in between those? Okay, so here's our region. So we have a diamond-shaped region versus a square. Now, I don't know about you, not the you in here, but you guys. Which region would seem more fun to work with?
Squares.
I guess by fun, I mean easier to work with, right? This one. This one, if you actually had to integrate over the region, you'd probably have to do a couple of different integrals to figure it out. Do you guys see what I'm talking about? Okay.
Wait, so we agree that it's the square?
Yes. The square is the one we want to work with. The analogy is, we've already kind of done this. Like, when we did polar, right? When we had, if we had the x and y bounds, sometimes those were crazy bounds, right? But when we looked at it in polar, they became a lot nicer to work with. It's the same idea. Okay. So now, let's go ahead and talk about how we can work with this. Here's the definition. Of a Jacobian. If x equals a function g of uv, y equals a function h of uv, then the Jacobian of x and y with respect to u and v is going to look kind of weird at first, but it's got a partial notation, but it's not actually the straight up partial derivative. I'll explain what this means. Okay, so this is what we call the Jacobian. The Jacobian of x and y with respect to u and v. Okay, and this is calculated by a 2x2 determinant, but it's easy to remember. We do partial x, partial u, partial x, partial v. So we just do the x with respect to u and v, and now we do the y with respect to u and v. Which, of course, I mean, we don't need to write the formula out, but you guys know how to find the 2x2 determinant, right? Okay? So. So this is the Jacobian, and this is the extra factor when converting integrals. Let me remind you. When we took rectangular coordinates, x, y, and z, and we said, boy, these are sure ugly, let's make it polar. What extra factor popped up in the integral?
R.
When we were in cylindrical, it was still r. What happened in spherical?
Rho squared
sine phi. Think of sine phi. think of them as, or think of this as, it's kind of like the scaling factor, taking one area to another, and it's kind of adjusting the different areas that we're looking at. Keeping it the same, this is a way that we can calculate it. Okay, so we're going to go ahead and prove that this actually works. Aw, you guys just want to trust me? No one wants to see the proof?
Does anyone want to see the proof?
Well, maybe.
All right, let's do the proof. So let me write out in symbols what I just said in a sentence. The double integral of R, or region R, of a function f of x, y, dx, dy, can be converted to a new set of coordinates. We'll call the new region of integration S, and now we're going to have new variables. Instead of X, it'll be a function X of UV. Instead of Y, it'll be a function Y of UV. And now, here's where we have that extra integrating factor, the scaling factor. That's going to be where the Jacobian goes. And since it's a scaling factor, we're going to do absolute value. Of whatever this factor ends up being. And now if we're converting to u's and v's, we're going to have du dv. Or as we saw earlier, dr d theta, or whatever. Oops, sorry. Or dr d theta, whatever the case is. Okay, so it's not too hard to see. Let's start with the uv plane. And start by defining a nice rectangular region, just to make things simple. Let's say this point here corresponds to UV. And now if we're going to talk integrals, we want to look at things that are really small, right? So all we're going to do is increase U by a tiny little bit. So now this corresponds to U plus, what do we use usually for increasing a tiny little bit? Delta U, V still good, and then over here I think we can fill them out now on our own, right? Here U is the same, and now it's V plus delta V, and then here we increase both. So here's our S region. Now, there's going to be some transformation T that takes this to X's and Y's, but maybe in the XY plane it's not such a nice region. But the argument here is that no matter what region it is, if these are really small, that we're going to be able to approximate them with tiny little parallelograms. So, let's say that that corresponds to 4 points, M, N. Let's say this is P and this is Q. So M, N, P, Q. So here's our region R. And now the coordinates for M. Well, to figure out the x-coordinate, we'd have to plug u and v into the x. So it'll be x of uv. To figure out the y, it'll be y of uv. The n-coordinate would be what? Well, I forgot the comma v, sorry. And then y of plus delta u comma v. And then for p, it's the same idea. I think this is going to correspond to where we did a change in both of them. So it'll be x of u plus delta u v plus delta v. And then y of u plus delta u, v plus delta v, plus u, and then q will be x of u, v plus delta v. You can write whatever you want. I'm just going to kind of try to keep things simple, and this is kind of the same spot. So, like, this one maps to M, this one maps to N, this one maps to Q, and this one maps to P.
Okay.
Okay. So, the question now is, what is dx dy in terms of u and v? That's the question. So here we have dx dy representing the area of the region R that we're integrating over, but if we're going to convert to u and v, we want to know how that translates. Well, we can approximate dA, which is going to be the area of R. If this is a parallelogram, how do we find the area of parallelograms? Let's think Calc 3, not geometry. What did we do to find area of parallelograms? Magnitude of the cross product of the two vectors, right? So, yes, we did. So, we're going to do MN crossed with, let's say, MQ. So let's figure out what that is. MN, let's just write out what that looks like in components. From M to N, we take final x coordinate minus initial. So that'll be x of u plus delta u, comma v, minus the initial x, which was just x of uv. That'll be the x component. The y component, same exact thing, just y's. Now, since we're talking very small, we're going to argue that this is approximately something else. How do we approximate change? Think Calc 3 again. What did we do in chapter, 13? To approximate a small change? The differential, yeah.
Yes, I knew it.
I was like, don't say it.
So,
I don't want to be wrong.
Notice that the...
Is it the same thing as a gradient?
No. It'll be... Let's write it this way. The change in x will be change in x, which is, partial u, basically, delta u, partial y with respect to u, delta u.
Is this the same thing as a gradient? No.
Not exactly, no.
Okay.
Which, just for the heck of it, I'm going to write with the notation that we're working with from before. Partial x, partial u, delta u. Partial y, partial u, delta u. Okay. The gradient does not include... Right. Now, instead of writing this out again, I'm sure you'll appreciate this, I'm going to say that MQ is going to be very similar in, as far as how we calculate it. So, the final vector for MQ would be what?
Partial x, partial v.
Yep. So now let's take a look at the cross product. So that's going to be I, J, K. And partial x, partial u, delta u, partial y, partial u, delta u. The k component is 0 for both. All right, so now if we go ahead and find the cross product, let's see. First component is just 0. Second component is 0. And the last component is going to be partial x, partial u, delta u, partial y, partial v, delta v. I wrote a little too big. Minus partial x partial v delta v times partial y partial u delta u.
Wait, hold on.
Okay. Now, we wanted to find the determinant of this, right? We don't have to do the fancy formula. If there's only one component, then the magnitude of this determinant is just going to be this k component, okay? Well, notice I could factor out a delta u and a delta v. So I'm going to put that at the end. And if I factor that out, what's left? Partial x, partial u, partial y, partial v, minus partial x, partial v, partial y, partial u. So all I'm doing is factoring out delta u and delta v from both of these terms, writing what's left, and this is the formula for, going back, this. You guys see that, right? That's the same thing as calculating the determinant of that. So, the conclusion is that as delta u approaches 0 and delta v approaches 0, that this area dA, which could be written as dx dy if we're in rectangular, and you know what? Let me just clarify that this needs absolute value. It's a magnitude. Just in case it's negative, we want to make things positive all the time. We're going to say that dx dy is equivalent to the Jacobian. The absolute value of the Jacobian is a better way of writing it.
Wait,
yes.
How can it be negative if it's du/dv?
Well, because the magnitude is first component squared, second component squared, third component squared, right? So that's the whole point. It can't be negative. So, but when you do the determinant of the 2x2 matrix, like for instance, if your vector component was 0, 0, negative 5, you just know that the magnitude is 5, right? Do you see what I'm saying? But like you potentially could get negative 5 when you calculate the Jacobian. So this is just a reminder that that's technically the magnitude of that little area, so it should always be positive. Does that make sense?
So it doesn't matter which way you cross them, right?
Technically, no, as long as you keep things positive. Yep. Okay? So that kind of shows that this is a valid formula. Dx, dy, if we're changing variables, we can switch variables to du, dv. We just have to calculate the Jacobian to figure out what that scaling factor is. Okay. Let's see. So let's do a couple of things. So some examples. Quick example. Let's say x equals r cosine theta, y equals r sine theta, and we want to find the Jacobian. Now, if you've been paying any attention today, you should already know the answer. Think about it for a second.
Okay.
What does a Jacobian represent? What variables are we switching to? What's the scaling factor when we convert to?
R.
Yeah, the answer should be R. Now, we're going to... Any surprise? Was that a guess?
No, I didn't surprise the guy.
So if you have, what x equals in spherical coordinates?
We're going to get rho squared sine phi. Exactly. All right? So the Jacobian is calculated by doing... So let's set up the 2x2 determinant. We would do partial x, partial r, partial x, partial theta, and then partial y, partial theta. So let's fill that in. What is partial x, partial r? A quiet cosine theta is correct. Partial x, partial theta is... negative r sine theta. Partial y, partial r. Partial y, partial theta. R cosine theta.
Is this what you said earlier that we're going to
explain? Yes. Believe it or not, it's going to be easier to show that it's rho squared sine phi using this rather than doing some ridiculous area calculation or volume calculation. So, okay, so let's see. We get what? R cosine squared minus a negative, so plus R sine squared. Factor out the R. You get R times 1. So there it is. Okay, so there's the scaling factor in polar. And before we get to the big rho squared sine phi finale, let's talk about how to do a general change. So let's say we want to evaluate 3xy dA, where R is bounded by x minus 2y equals 0, x minus 2y equals negative 4, x plus y equals 4, and x plus y equals 1. Because these are the boundaries.
Oh.
So when you draw them... Let's see. This one is just a slope that's going to look kind of like that. I'm just drawing a rough sketch here. This one is going to have a y-intercept of 2, x-intercept of negative 4. X plus y equals 4. That's just, what was that, 2? So this should be up here somewhere, 4, 4. So here's x plus y equals 4, x plus y equals 1. I'm just drawing them. So here's R. That's not a very fun region to be integrating over. Okay? Now, I don't know about you guys, but there's something that seems pretty obvious as what substitutions you should make here. Not polar. We want to do a general change, so let's let u equal something, and let's let v equal something. X minus 2y is going to be u. and V equals X plus Y. Because now, how do I know to do that?
Yeah.
Because now the boundaries are U equals 0, U equals negative 4, and then V equals 4 and V equals 1, which translates to a rectangle.
Right, right.
Like, that's much easier to do than this.
Would they always
sure.
be the
same?
It's going to be obvious what substitution you should make.
It's always going to be the same.
Yeah.
Oh.
Okay. So.
Mr. D.
Yep. What's that?
What if we didn't have like two sets of parallel lines? Like instead of having.
It'll be obvious. Yeah, she did.
What's that?
It'll be very clear what substitution to make.
Are you sure?
Yes, I'm sure. If you switch them, no, it's not going to make a difference. Nope. So let's set it up. So now we have U equals 0, U equals negative 4, V equals 4, V equals 1, which translates in the UV plane. If U equals 0 and U equals negative 4, and then V equals 4, V equals 1. Now here's S. Okay. So now, do you guys kind of see what we have to do here? If we're going to convert this integral, if we want to change the integral of 3xy dA into U's and V's, we need to find first the Jacobian, because we want to know what that extra factor is that's scaling the area to the appropriate change in variables. Okay? So we're going to first, we want to know what X is, right? What is X? What is Y? Because if we have x equals a function of uv and y equals a function of uv, then you can do all the partials. Okay, so let's take a look. We have, what was it? U equals x minus 2y, v equals x plus y. We're going to do kind of the same trick we did earlier. Let's see, if I subtract, that cancels out the x's, and I get an equation for y, right? So I would get u minus v would equal negative 3y. Do you guys see that? So then y would be, I'll factor out a negative and switch v or u minus v to v minus u.
You do that a lot.
What's that?
You do that a lot.
I do. I don't like negatives. So there's y. To cancel out the y's, I would have to first double this equation, right? And what? Just add. So we get that u plus 2v has to equal x plus 2x. There you go, 3x. So 1/3 u plus 2v is going to be x. So now we have our x equation, and now we have our y equation. Let's go ahead and find the Jacobian. So the Jacobian of x and y with respect to u and v is the 2 by 2 determinant represented by, and again, you don't have to keep writing the formula out, but it's going to help remember it if you do it a few times. It's partial x, partial u, partial x, partial v, partial y, partial u, partial y, partial v, and let's fill those in. It's not a hard determinant. Partial x partial u would be what? 1/3. Partial x partial v? 2/3. Partial y partial u? -1/3. Partial y partial v? 1/3. So we get 1/9 minus negative 2/9. So really, 1/3. Now, if it were the case that this was negative 1/3, in the integral, you would put in 1/3 because it's a scaling factor. Does that make sense?
But always positive.
Always positive. Okay. So now the final step is to switch the variables. So, 3, what's x? It's not x anymore.
No, it is actually 1/3 u plus 2v.
Very good.
What's y?
What's y?
1/3 v minus u.
So, let's say we go, and see, this is the nice thing. The bounds are just constants, right? Because u and v were from just constants, so we can put whatever order we want, du, dv, but don't forget, here we need the, this is the Jacobian, right? That's like the r that we do you saw in polar, but in this case, it's just 1/3. So if I clean this up a little bit, let's see. 3 times 1/3. So we're just going to have 1/9. And you know what? I won't finish it, but we'll set it up. 1/9 u plus 2v, v minus u. And let's say I kept it du, dv. So what are the bounds for u? So negative 4 to 0. And v was from 1 to 4. So this is the final setup, and this is now a nicer integral to calculate. And I know you can do the work. The answer is 164 over 9. Now, we're running out of time for the big finale. I'm sorry. But, Mr. Eric doesn't need the syllabus. The final example would have been something like this. Find Jacobian of the transformation x equals rho sine phi cosine theta, y equals rho sine phi sine theta, z equals rho cosine phi. And the way you would set that up, now you just do 3 variables, because you will see a couple of these. The Jacobian of x, y, and z with respect to rho, phi, theta. So instead of u and v, now we have just 3 variables, rho, phi, theta. Would be partial x, partial phi. Do you guys get the idea here? Partial x, partial, I said phi, I meant rho. Partial x, partial rho, partial x, partial phi, partial x, partial theta, and so on and so forth. And if you're really interested, what should the answer be?
Rho squared sine
phi. That's
so exciting.
Yeah, kind of anticlimactic. But you guys trust me at this point, I hope. If you want to work it out, it does work out to rho squared sine phi. Sorry, we're done with 14.7. I'll see you guys on Monday.
So you do like a triple?
A 3 by 3, yeah.
I don't know if he knows what I'm talking about. I'll take that.